गुड मॉर्निंग डियर स्टूडेंट्स।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग। ओके सो टुडे वी गोइंग टू स्टार्ट ए टॉपिक रिगार्डिंग इवोल्यूशन ऑफ द सिलोम। ओके सो दिस टॉपिक बिलोंग्स टू योर फर्स्ट पेपर, पेपर C03। ओके सो इज द स्क्रीन इज विजिबल?
यस सर।
ओके सो द टॉपिक इज इवोल्यूशन ऑफ द सिलोम। सो बेसिकली इन द लास्ट क्लास वी हैव डिस्कस अबाउट द इवोल्यूशन ऑफ द मेटाबॉलिज्म। ओके सो टुडे यू गो फॉर द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक, द इवोल्यूशन ऑफ द सिलोम। सो व्हाट इज अ सिलोम? नाउ यू कैन सी सिलोम। The cilium is a main body cavity in most animals and is positioned inside the body to surround and contain the digestive tract and other organs. In some animals, it is lined with mesothelium. Okay, so you can see what is the cilium. The cilium is a body cavity which is lined by two different membranes. One is the ectoderm and one is the endoderm. Okay, so in between the ectoderm and the endoderm, there's a cavity is there, and this cavity is called as a body cilium. So you can see in the regular diagram. Okay, so you can see this is the endoderm, this is the endoderm membrane. Okay, and you can see this is the ectoderm. So blue color area, this is the ectoderm, and then this yellow color area, this is the endoderm. Okay, so in between the ectoderm and the endoderm, you can see there is a hollow area, white color area. So this hollow white color area is called as the body cavity. Okay, or you can also say as a body cilium. Okay, so you can see in this body cilium, both side, inner side and the outer side, some membranes are there. So this is one membrane. Okay, this is one membrane and this is another membrane. Okay, so this membrane which is connected to the endoderm, and this membrane is called inner mesoderm. This is called inner mesoderm. Okay, and this is another membrane. This membrane is connected to the ectoderm, and this membrane is called outer mesoderm. That means the cilium is formed inside the mesoderm. The body cavity or the cilium is formed inside the mesoderm. That means the mesoderm is splitted into two different parts, and one side becomes inner mesoderm, outside becomes the outer mesoderm. And in between the inner mesoderm and the outer mesoderm, there is a cavity is there. Okay, and this particular cavity is called as the body cilium. So this is the body cilium. Okay, so in some organisms, this particular body cilium is complete. So this is complete cilium. You can see this is complete. But over here, there is a mesentery area. This is one connection of mesentery. This is another connection of mesentery. But you can say this is a complete cilium. Okay, because in the left side also and in the right side also the cavity is complete. Okay, so this type of cilium is called complete cilium, or you can also say you can also call as a true cilium. Okay, this is called as a true cilium, or you can also say the complete cilium. Okay, so in some animals this cilium is not completed. Okay, somewhat suppose over here some areas are there, this is the cilium. Over here some other areas are there, this is the cilium. Like that, but this is not completed. Okay, so this type of cilium which is not completed, they are called as a pseudo cilium. They may be called as a pseudo cilium. Okay, and then another form is there which is called a cilium. A cilium means there is no cilium. Suppose this white area is not there in some animals. This white part area is not there. This is completely covered with this pink color cells. Okay, you can see these are pink color cells are there. So these pink color cells also completed this white color area also. Okay, then we can found that ectoderm, mesoderm and the endoderm, but there is no cavity in between. Okay, because this cavity is filled with the mesodermal cells. Okay, so this type of cilium is called as the a cilium. A cilium means there is no cilium. Okay, so basically the cilums are the three different types: a cilium, then you can say pseudo cilium. That means over here the cilium is there but not complete. This is called pseudo cilium. and last one is a complete cilium or maybe called as a true cilium. So this is the example of a true cilium. Okay, this is an example of a true cilium. So this is the basic concept and basic knowledge about the cilium, that the cilium cavity is filled with a particular fluid. Okay, so this is a one type of hydrostatic fluid. So this particular fluid allows all the internal organs, they can move freely. Okay, suppose you can see inside our body, intestines are there, okay, stomach is there. So that means what? During the peristaltic movement, our intestine and our stomach, they also move. Okay, because when the intestine and the stomach is filled with the food, then what happens? Due to the peristaltic movement, they are digested. And because of the peristaltic movement, they may be contracted or they may be relaxed. Relaxation of the intestine may be occurs, or contraction of the intestine may be occurs. So because of that, their space may be enlarged or their space may be decreases. That means, so that the all the internal organs, they can expand or they can again go to the previous their shape. So in this condition, they have to need some space in the particular body. Okay, so this particular space is provided by the cilium. Okay, that means inside this endoderm, you can see, so over here all the organs are there. Inside this area, the organs are there. So these organs are freely moved because of this particular area. Okay, so they can be expanded from there up to the here. They can expand, and again they can be again come back to the ray their original structure. Okay, like that they can expand and again come back to the original structure, because this particular area provide the space for the internal organs so that they can expand or again go to the next their original state. Okay, so this is the main mechanism of the body cilium, and this is the importance of the body cilium, because they provide external space for the internal organs. Okay, this is number one. Then number two, you can see they are filled with the fluid. I already said this particular fluid is called as a cilomic fluid. Okay, this fluid is called cilomic fluid. Now see, you can see this is the ectoderm, this is the internal organs, and this is the cilomic fluid is there. Okay, now see, when our body immune cells, you can see neutrophil, basophil, these are the body immune cell. So this body immune cell, they have to travel from the internal structure to the outer structure, to the skin also they have to travel. So how they travel between this? Because first these immune cells are traveling to the body cilium. Okay, they absorb by the body cilium, then from the body cilium they are absorbed by the ectoderm. Okay, suppose you have been any type of tissue injury in the ectoderm, so these immune cells may be come from the body cilium to the tissue injury part. Okay, so this area also serves as the exchange of the cells between from one part to the another part, and these cells may be the blood cells or maybe the immune cells. Okay, so these are the basic structure and function of the body cilium. Now you go for the different aspects of the body cilium, you can see. Okay, now you can see the development, how the body cilium is developed. Okay, that means the origin of the body cilium, how it is originated. Okay, so because of the development of the body cilium, basically the cilium are two different types. Okay, so one is called schizocilous development and one is called enterocilous development. Okay, so that means the development of the cilium basically gone through two different types of developmental phases. One may be schizocilous and one is called enterocilous. Okay, now see, before going to that, we have to know about one point, is that some animals are called as the protostomas and some animals are called as a deuterostomas. Okay, now what is protostomas and what is deuterostomas? Okay, so protostomas means that those animal during their course of development, their mouth is developed first and then anus is developed later. Okay, those animals during their embryonic development, their mouth part is developed first and then the anus is developed. So these type of animals are called as the protostomas animal. Protostomas. Okay, P-R-O-T-O-S-T-O-M-O-U-S. Protostomas animals. So these animals having development of mouth first, later on the development of the anus during the embryonic development. Okay, now see, those animals are protostomas. These animals having the schizocoelous type of coelom development. Those animals are protostomas. These animals having the schizocoelous type of coelom development. Remember this. So all the protostomas animals, they showing the schizocoelous type of coelom development. Okay. Now what is enterocoelous? Some animals are called as deuterostomas. Some animals are called as deuterostomas. 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 Now what is deuterostomas? During the course of development, during the embryonic stage, in this condition, their anus is developed first, then develop the mouth. First they develop the anus, then they develop the mouth. Okay, so these type of animals during the embryonic stage, first they develop the anus, then they develop the mouth. So this type of animals are called as the deuterostomas animal. Okay, so all the deuterostomas animals, they showing enterocoelous type of coelom development. All the deuterostomas animals, they are showing enterocoelous type of coelom development. Okay, now see, what is the difference between schizocoelous and enterocoelous? Okay, so you can understand by this particular diagram. Okay, now see, this is the embryonic stage. This is the embryonic stage of the protostomas, because this is the example of schizocoelous and this is the example of enterocoelous. Okay, now see, all the protostomas animals, this is the embryonic stage. Okay, so in this condition you can see this particular area is called blastopore, and this cavity, is called archenteron. Okay, so we all know that archenteron is a cavity which is found during the gastrula stage. Okay, so during the embryonic stage development, different stages are there: morula, blastula, gastrula, then organogenesis. Okay, so during the stage of this one, gastrula, they having a cavity, and this cavity is called archenteron. This is the archenteron cavity. Okay, and this area is called as a blastopore, because from this particular area the development process started, and this area is called blastopore, and this is the cavity. This cavity is called archenteron. Okay, so you can see this is a blue color area. This particular area is called ectoderm. So this is the ectoderm. Okay, and this one yellow color area, this area is called endoderm. Okay, so during the course of development, first they produce the ectoderm, then they produce the endoderm. Okay, but basically mesoderm is produced lately during the embryonic stage. Mesoderm is produced lately. First they produce the ectoderm, then they produce the endoderm, and last one they produce the mesoderm. Okay, now see, in this particular area some red color cells are there. You can see these are the red color cells. So these red color cells are called early mesodermal cells. So these cells are called early mesodermal cells. Okay, so during the course of development, these cells are migrated from this area, from the blastopore area. These cells are migrated to the whole covering of the embryo. They are migrated from there, they are migrated this side, they are migrated this side, and after that they produces these two pouch like structure. This is one pouch, this is another pouch. Okay, so these two pouches are developed from the migratory cells of the early mesoderm cells. So these cells are migrated over here, and these cells are migrated over here, and they produce two pouches in the both side. Okay, then these pouches are again during the development bigger in size. You can see this becomes bigger in size, this is also bigger in size. Okay, and finally inside the pouches, some is there is a space is there. Okay, and this space is called as the coelomic space, or this is called as body coelom. Okay, so in this mesoderm, you can see this is the inner side of the mesoderm and this is the outer side of the mesoderm. The inner side is called inner mesodermal membrane. This is connected to the endoderm, and this is called outer mesodermal membrane. This is connected to the ectoderm. Like that, this side also, this is the inner side, this is the outer side, and this is the cavity, and this cavity is called the body coelom. Okay, So this type of development of body cilium is called schizocoelous development. Schizocoelous development, and this is found in the protostomous animals. Okay. Now we need to know about the examples. Examples of protostomous animal. The protostomous animal example ki hoba? The examples are tatoman hoba arthropoda, mollusca. Arthropoda, mollusca. These are the protostomous animals. Arthropoda, mollusca, and also annelida. Annelida, arthropoda, mollusca. These are the protostomous animals. Okay. And then starting from the echinodermata. Starting from echinodermata up to the all vertebrates, echinodermata, fishes, amphibia, reptile, apes, and the mammals, and all these classes having the enterocoelous type of cilium development. Okay, but basically schizocoelous is found in the annelida, arthropoda, and the mollusca. In annelida, in arthropoda, and mollusca, schizocoelous type of development is found. And enterocoelous is found in from starting from the echinodermata up to the mammals. Okay, now we can go for the enterocoelous. You can see, so in the enterocoelous type of development, you can see this is the outer ectoderm. You can see outer ectoderm. This is the endoderm, yellow color. So during the course of development of enterocoelous, from the endoderm, small two pouches are arises. This is one pouch, this is another pouch. Small two pouches are arises from the endoderm. First, during the course of embryonic development, small two pouches are arises from the endoderm. And later on, these two pouches are detached from the endoderm. From this endoderm, both the pouches are detached. Then, both the pouches are migrated and becomes bigger in size. Okay, and finally, both the pouches cover the whole area of the embryo. Okay, and inside this pouch, they having a fluid filled cavity, and this fluid filled cavity is called cilium, body cilium. And finally, they produce the body cilium. That means both the structure, this structure and this structure, both are looks like exactly similar, but their origin of development is different. Okay, so schizocoelous having the, these are the cells, mesodermal cells, these are migrated, and then they become split to form the this one cavity. Splitting of mesoderm, and they form the cavity. This is occurring in the schizocoelous. And what is enterocoelous? They form two pouches from the endoderm, then two embryonic pouches are detached from the endoderm, and finally both the pouches are bigger in size and they cover the whole area of the embryo. And finally, they form the cavity, and this cavity is called cilium. Okay, so just to remember, enterocoelous type of development is found starting from the echinodermata up to the mammals, and then annelida, arthropoda, and the mollusca having schizocoelous type of development. Okay, so this is the development of the cilium. Okay, then we need the different divisions of the cilium, or you can see ciliomic division of the metazoa. Okay, so what are the division? I already said basically ciliums are three different types of body ciliums are found. Okay, so this is the number one type. This type is called acilium, or you can say acilomate, acilium or acilomate. So this type is called pseudocilium, and this type is called true cilium. That means the cilium are basically three different types: acilium, pseudocilium, and true cilium. Okay, first go for the acilium. What is acilium? Okay, so I already said in the acilium, they do not have any type of body cavity. In the acilium, they do not have any type of body cavity. Okay, so this is the area. This is not a body cavity, and this area is called acilium. Okay, and this actually, there is no cavity. This area is filled with some type of cells, and these cells are called parenchyma cells. Remember, so in the acilomate, there is no cavity, cavity is absent, and this area is filled with some type of cells, and these cells are called parenchyma cell. Parenchyma. PARENCHYMA. Parenchyma cells. So this area is filled with parenchyma cell. Okay. So acoelomate is found in two different groups. One group is called porifera and one is called coelenterata. In porifera and in coelenterata, they do not have any coelom, and this area is filled with the parenchyma cells. Okay. Now one question to all of you. Why the porifera and the coelenterata do not have any coelom? Anyone can answer. Why porifera and coelenterata do not have any body coelom? Anyone can ask. Why? Why the porifera and the coelenterata do not have the body coelom? Why? Okay, I will explain. Now see, porifera and the coelenterata, they do not have the mesoderm, because these are diploblastic animal. Porifera, coelenterata, these are diploblastic animal. So in the diploblastic animal, they have the ectoderm and the endoderm. Okay, but they do not have the mesoderm. If they do not have the mesoderm, how they can produce the coelom? Because coelom is formed from the splitting of mesoderm. I already said, coelom body cavity or the coelom is formed from the mesoderm. If they do not have the mesoderm, so how they can develop the body coelom? That's why in the porifera and the coelenterata, they do not have the body coelom, and the area is filled with the parenchyma cells. Okay? And this is another example. This is called pseudocoelom. Okay, so pseudocoelom is found in the escalmentis. In the escalmentis, pseudocoelom is found. Okay, you can see in the escalmentis, they are called the triploblastic animal. Example of escalmentis, they are triploblastic animal. They having the ectoderm, they having mesoderm, and they having the endoderm. Okay, but the mesoderm of the escalmentis, they cannot form the complete body coelom. They cannot form a complete body coelom. You can see. So they having some pouches like structure. Okay, say this is the one pouch, this is another pouch, this is another pouch, this is another pouch. This is the endoderm, this is the ectoderm. Okay. So these pouches are not attached to each other. These pouches are not attached to each other, and this is not complete. This is not completed. Okay. That's why they having a coelom. You can see this is a space. This is another space, this is another space, this is another space. So they having a coelom, but this coelom is not completed. Okay, that's why this type of body coelom is called pseudocoelom. And pseudocoelom type of body coelom is shown by escalmentis. Example ki hobo escalmentis, sir? Example is the ascaris. You all know ascaris. So ascaris is an example of pseudocoelom type. Okay, their body coelom is not completed. They are like some pouches. And these pouches are not attached to each other, all are separated. Okay. Then this is the last one, it is already discussed. This is called through coelom. Okay. So in the through coelom, the coelom is complete. You can see this is one complete coelom, this is another complete coelom. Okay. So this is the mesoderm area, this is the mesoderm area. So the through coelom is formed by the splitting of mesoderm or from the embryonic pouches from endoderm. Okay. If the embryonic pouches from the endoderm, this type of development is called enterocoelous. And if the splitting of mesoderm occurs, this is called schizocoelous. But both are through coelom. That means through coelom is found from the annelida. Starting from annelida, the through coelom is found. Annelida, mollusca, and the arthropoda. These three having the schizocoelom. Then from echinodermata up to the mammals, they having the enterocoelom. Okay, so these are the three types of body coelom, or you can say coelomic division of the metazoa. Okay, now we need another important parameters. The parameter is the theories regarding the origin of coelom. What are the different theories are there which are recognized as the origin of body cilium. Okay, so basically four different theories are already described by different scientists, so we need to know about these particular theories. So first theory, number A, this is called caesocele theory. Okay, this is already discussed, caesocele theory. What is caesocele theory? Okay, and this theory is described by a scientist called Clark in 1964. He discovered the theory of caesocele theory. Okay, now what is caesocele theory? So caesocele theory, I already said, the splitting of mesoderm, which is found near to the blastopore area, they are migrated to the whole body of the embryo, then after the splitting of mesoderm, they can form the complete body cilium, and this cilium is called caesocelous type of body cilium, and this theory is explained by a scientist, Clark, in 1964. Okay, so this is the first theory. Then second theory B, anterocele theory. Okay, so anterocele theory is described first by Lancaster in 1877. So Lancaster first develop this theory 1877. Then other scientists supported the theory of the anterocelous theory. The other scientists are Sedgwick, Hartmann, and the Rehm. These three scientists accepted the theory of the anterocele theory. Okay, so according to Lancaster, he said that anterocelous origin, that means two embryonic pouches are generated from the endoderm, and then both the embryonic pouches are separated from the endoderm, then they become bigger in size and they surrounded the whole body area and they form the cilium, and this cilium is called anterocelum type. Okay, so already discussed these two, caesocelum and the anterocelum. Then number C, you can see gonocele theory. So this is somewhat different. So what is gonocele theory? This theory is described by Burge in 1885. He first discovered this particular theory, gonocele theory, Burge in 1885. Then this theory is again developed by other scientists, just like Hatzsack, Mayer, and the Goodrich. So these three scientists again developed the gonocele theory. So what is gonocele theory? So according to the gonocele theory, this is the diagram, you can see, this is the diagram. Okay, you can see in annelida, example of what, you can see the leeches. Okay, in annelida, leeches and the earthworm and the leeches, they having numerous gonads. Okay, they having numerous gonads, you all know. You can see the example of the leeches. So in the leeches, they having numerous gonads. Okay, they having 11 pairs of testes and 17 pairs of the nephridia. Okay, you all remember. So these gonads are present in both the sizes. This side also gonads are present, this side also gonads are present. Okay, now every gonad is separated by some area. Okay, every gonad is separated by some area, and this area is filled with a particular fluid, and this area is called as a one type of cilium. You can see, this is one cilium, this is one cilium, this is one cilium, and inside this cilium the gonads are present in the both side. Okay, so every gonad, they accumulate a particular space. According to Burge, he said that every gonad are accumulated a particular space. Another topic is the theory is the gonocele theory. So what is gonocele theory? This is described by Burge in 1885. So, and this scientist, they can accept this particular theory of the gonocele theory. Okay, so according to Burge, he said that some animals, just like annelida, example is a leeches. So in the leeches, they having numerous gonads. Okay, in the both side, they having numerous gonads are there. Okay, now every gonad, they can surrounded by a particular area. The area is covered by a space. Okay, you can see there's a chamber. So they can form a chamber, okay, and every chamber having one gonad, and this chamber is filled with the fluid. Okay, and then every gonad is covered by a particular chamber, and every chamber is filled with a fluid, and finally in the both side they produce the long cilomic cavities. Okay, and finally the animals having the gonads as well as they having the cilomic cavities. Okay, and this theory is considered by gonosil theory, which is described by Bars in 1885. Okay. And the last one, number D, nephrosil theory. Now, what is nephrosil theory? Same example. Example is the leeches. Okay. So, in the leeches as well as in the artworm, you all know that they having numerous nephridia. So, in the artworm, they having 17 pairs of nephridia. Okay. So, every nephridia, they can accumulate it just like a space. This space is accumulated by every nephridia. Okay. And then the space is covered by a chamber, and this chamber is filled with the fluid in case of the nephridia. So, starting from the their whole body, starting from the anterior side up to the posterior side, every nephridia is accumulated with a chamber, and this chamber is filled with a fluid, and they produce in the both side cavities. Okay, and this is called as a nephrosil theory. Nephrosil theory, and this theory is given by Lancaster in 1874. So Lancaster also provided another theory, anterosil theory, Lancaster in 1877. Okay, so before giving this theory, anterosil theory, Lancaster first provided nephrosil theory. You can see the year 1874, but it's 1877. So, nephrosil theory is first given by Lancaster in 1874. Later on, Lancaster modified his theory up to anterosil theory, and it is just defined in 1877. Okay? So, that means the nephrosil theory and the gonosil theory, these two theories are not accepted by all the research scientists. Okay? Still, it is not accepted by all the scientists. So, gonosil theory and the nephrosil theory, these two theories are rejected, but basically we are accepted these two theories, schizosil theory and the anterosil theory. Schizosil theory is given by Clark and anterosil theory is given by Lancaster in 1877. Okay, so during your preparation of the note on the evolution of the psyllium, you have to describe about the psyllium, what is psyllium, then you can go for the you can say next one. Okay, first you describe the psyllium, then you go for the development of the psyllium. Development is basically two different types, schizocyllus development and the enterocyllus development. Okay, then you go for the most important, the types of the body psyllium. Types, or you can say psylomic division of the metazoa, or the types of the body psyllium. Basically three different types, acylomate, pseudocylomate and the true psyllium. Okay, you have to describe what is acylom, what is pseudocylom and what is true psyllium. Okay. Then later on you go for the different theories regarding the origin of the psyllium. Okay, basically four different theories are there: schizocyl theory, anterosyl theory, gonosyl theory and the nephrosyl theory. Among this all theory, gonosyl theory and the nephrosyl theory, these two are completely rejected by all the scientists, and we are accepting two theories. One is the schizocyl theory and another is the anterosyl theory. Okay, and these two theories are described by Clark in 1964, schizocyl theory, and the anterosyl theory is described by Lancaster in 1877. Okay, the gonosyl theory and the nephrosyl theory, these two are rejected. Why they are rejected? Because the point is that they describe these two theories based on the annelida origin, because annelida having the numerous gonads. What about arthropoda? What about mollusca? What about echinodermata? And what about vertebrates? Because we do not have the several gonads. So how our body psyllium is formed? That's why the gonosyl theory and the nephrosyl theory, these two are rejected. Schizocyllus origin and the anterocyllus origin, these two are widely accepted by all the scientists. Okay, and nowadays also we can go for only these two theories, schizocyllus and the anterocyllus. But in exam purpose, you have to write schizocyllus, anterocyllus, gonosyllus and the nephrosyllus. All four you have to describe in your examination purpose. Okay, so this is about it. This is a small topic regarding the evolution of the body psyllium. Okay, thank you.